गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, माई सेल्फ हिमांशु जैन, AIR 44 दिस टाइम. सो अ बेसिक इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट मी, आई हैव डन माई ग्रेजुएशन फ्रॉम IIIT हैदराबाद एंड आई एम ऑल्सो ए पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट फ्रॉम द सेम इंस्टीट्यूट. आई हैव फिनिश्ड माई ग्रेजुएशन एंड पोस्ट ग्रेजुएशन इन 2014 एंड आई केम बैक टू दिल्ली फॉर प्रिपरेशन. दिस वॉज माई थर्ड अटैम्प्ट एंड I got 44, and also this was my first interview. I could not qualify mains last two times. So let's begin with my journey, the strategy of how I cracked this exam and got 44th rank. So I'll be starting with prelims part, how to prepare, because as you all know, there are three stages of this examination. First stage is prelim, second is mains, and third one is interview. So for the prelims, there is a complete different strategy for all the three parts. So you have to be prepared for all the three stages very differently. So let's begin with prelims, how you should prepare for prelims. Prelims as such has become very much competitive because there are around 10 to 12 lakh people appearing for prelims every year, and the number is keep on increasing. So the competition at prelims level, I think, is very, very tough. And those people who are preparing for Indian Forest Services, they need to work more hard because the cutoff is like 15 marks more for the Indian Forest Services. I hope everyone is familiar with the civil services pattern. So is there anyone who is not familiar with the pattern? Okay, so I'm assuming everyone is familiar. Okay, so now there are several subjects in prelims that you have to study. There is a myth that UPSC cover everything under the sun. I think this is a complete myth. UPSC does not cover everything under the sun. We have to be very focused and we have to be very specific what we can study, because there is a limit to everyone. So I'll be talking about like different subjects that we have to cover in as part of our prelims. So as you know, there are different subjects like polity, economy, please note down, polity, economy, then there is geography, then there is history. In the history you can write modern history, medieval history, ancient history, art and culture. Then there is geography I have covered, economics, polity, history, then there is science and tech, then there is environment, what else, the government schemes or current affairs, then area left. So I think everything is covered. So now write for each of the subject what books you have to study. For polity, I think Lakshmikant, everyone knows, that is the basic book, and that is the, you can say, the whole compilation of polity is there in the Lakshmikant. So read only Lakshmikant and read newspapers, polity will be covered. Now coming to the geography, you should read 11th, 12th geography of NCERT of geography, along with GC Leong, along with some mapping practice from Atlas. You can also refer to the Mrunal videos of geography, that they are very good, and I have seen them. Or you can, for stray topics, you can refer to Savinder Singh or all. So geography will be finished. Apart from this, now coming to history, in modern history you can refer to Spectrum. Spectrum is a very good book. Those who don't want to read Spectrum, they can refer to Bibin Chandra. Bibin Chandra is also a very good book. Now in modern history you should cover between 1757 to 1947. Only this period questions will be asked. Now coming to the ancient history, you should read R.S. Sharma. It is a very good book, R.S. Sharma. For medieval history, you can refer to Satish Chandra. I have not read Satish Chandra in my whole three-year period. I only refer to some notes from Coaching Institute. So you can also refer to some compilation from a Coaching Institute, or you can refer to the Lucent guide that comes, which help you in covering medieval history. Now, coming to the next art and culture. Art and culture, you can refer to Nitin Singhania book. It's a very good book and the compilation is very good. So history is covered, geography is covered, quality is covered. Now coming to the economy section. In the economy section, they will ask some basic questions. Mostly the questions will be asked from the current affairs. Here, the Hindu newspaper will help you. So try to cover current affairs from the Hindu newspaper or any newspaper which you like. Along with this, you should also refer to some basic book of economy like Dharmeshing or any basic book. Apart from this, try to refer a site called Mrunal. It's a very good site for economy, and I referred it and I found it very useful. So this is economy section. Now for environment, you can refer to the other notes that are available in the market, Shankar IS or any compilation that is there. So these are the whole four prelims. And for current affairs, you should read Vision, which is a very good book, which is a very 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 good compilation of current affairs, and also newspaper. So these two things will help you a lot, and you will not miss anything in the current affairs section. Also, for government documents, you should read budget, you should read government surveys, government economic survey, and any other report which has come, like forest report or any other report. So I think this will cover your prelim part, but this is only the reading part. Now you should focus on the practice part. Practice part is more important. Try to get question papers of test series, and try as many as questions as possible. So what I used to do is I used to practice two papers daily and in alternate days. So that helped me a lot. I practiced around 40 papers. So just go with that and you'll be able to crack prelims with 140 or plus marks. What you should do is never spend more than 2 months solely for prelims, because I have read it. I have also followed this strategy and it worked. So because there is a mains that you have to give, and you should also focus upon the mains part. You should also give a regular test for the mains. So what you should do is, for prelims, pick a subject, for example, polity. Read from Lakshmikant. It will take you 2 to 3 days. Also read the your current affair notes. And then try to solve 3-4 papers of polity on the next day. So this will cover whole polity part, and you will feel very relaxed that you have covered whole polity. Similarly goes for environment, similarly for modern history. Do this, and in span of like 1.5 months, you will be able to cover whole of prelims part. And I can assure you that you will get a very good marks in prelims. So this was my whole strategy for prelims, and luckily I never failed in prelim, so I can share this strategy with you. Now the prelim part is over. Coming to the mains part. Mains part is very important, because here you have to write answers, and it is very different, you can say, arena from the prelims, because here you have to write subjective answers which require immense practice and which require immense representation skills. Now those skills can be developed over a period of time. It is not that you are born with the representative skills. You can develop your skills with time, because I failed in mains twice, so I can share this strategy with you, that with the time you can improve your skills of your representative skills. Now how you should improve your representative skills, that is the question. Solve as many as paper as possible. Give as many mains paper as possible. For example, read, if you have read GS1, try to give 2-3 papers of GS1, then again go with GS1, read it once, and then give paper of GS1. First of all, give partial papers, for example, society, geography, history, then give full papers. So this will help you make your temperament that you are able to give, solve 3-hour paper completely in time. And also, after writing your answer, you should analyze that whether your answers are written very good or not. And then now how to analyze whether you have written a good answer or not. For analyzing whether you have written a good answer, first you should read yourself, and then you should also refer your answer to your friend. Your friend will give you very good suggestions that your answer is good, bad, or decent. you should also make diagrams in your answer. You should also make flowcharts in your answer as applicable in the question. Don't try to force it. As applicable, you should try to incorporate it, because it will make your answer non-monotonous than others' answer. So for answer writing, the main key point is practice. Practice, practice, practice. Just write answers more and more and more. And I think you should solve 10 papers or 5 to 10 papers of each paper. Like, there are 7 papers that we have in mains. You should solve each of the 7 papers 7 times. Give 7 mock tests of each paper. That will help you a lot in the mains examination. What I used to do is I used to treat every alternate week as a mains week, and I used to give exam treat it as a mains examination. So I used to give 7 exam in the alternate week, so that you can follow. That helped me a lot. Okay. So now, before so this was all about answer writing. Now let me come to how you should be able to grasp the content. For writing an answer, you should have content. Initially, I used to make offline notes, but in the first 2 attempts, but I could not compile them properly. So at the end, what happened was everything get very cluttered and everything got very clumsy. So in the 3rd attempt, I thrown away everything and I made online notes in the WordPad, and that helped me a lot, because I was able to compile GST at a very specific position, and I can read it very, very large number of times. So that will help you in compiling your notes. So try to make your notes online or offline as comfortable to you. But for me, I think online notes worked, because I was able to revise the notes many, many times, and that helped me in grasping the content. Next thing, I think what you should do is read the question very carefully. If you are not reading the question very carefully, then I think you won't be able to answer the question very specifically. In the UPSC mains examination, you won't get much time, but I think you should spend at least 30 seconds in reading the question, understanding the question. Understand each and every part of the question. If possible, try to highlight the main keyword of the question, because that will help you in answering the question very carefully, and each of the part very carefully. You won't skip any of the part of the question. So do this and read first question very carefully. Now answer each part of the question. Don't skip any part of the question. Try to incorporate as many points as possible in your answer, because it's a psychology of examiner that he will see how many points you have written. If the question is of, say, 12.5 marks and the distribution is 4 and 8.5, you should write at least 15 to 20 points. If you can divide your 15 to 20 points in multiple dimension, for example, what are the positives, what are the negatives, what are the government initiatives, and what can be done. So what I used to do is, for example, if there is a question on Jan Dhan Yojana, Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana has been, it's not been very successful and all. So first you should give a very brief introduction of what is Jan Dhan Yojana, or a fact about financial inclusion. You can start with this introduction. And then in the next part, direct jump to the question and answer the question. So in the next part, just write the specific feature of the Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana, then criticize what are the negatives of Prime Minister Jan Dhan Yojana, and then in the next part, what I used to do is I used to make a diagram and then say what the government is doing for financial inclusion, the other parameters of the government. Some people will say that this will not help because you are diverting from the question, but I think for me it worked, because the examiner will get a different perspective that government is doing different things for the financial inclusion. And in the conclusion, I will conclude what government else can do for the financial inclusion. I will just write a suggestion that government can do this for financial inclusion. So this was my whole strategy of answer writing. You can divide this into weekly. For example, after your prelims, you will have more like 3 months for mains, and for 3 months will be like around 12 to 15 weeks. So you can divide this into weekly, how in the first week, what subject you will read and how many papers you will practice. I used to practice 4 papers a week. So whatever suits you, do practice as many papers as possible. That will only sail you through the mains examination. Otherwise, you won't be able to sail through mains examination if you are not practicing enough. And make diagrams. And also, what I want to share one more thing. Don't solve 5 questions, 2 questions, or 3 questions, and extrapolate that with 3 hours. For example, many people solve 6 questions in an hour, and they will say, okay, I can solve 18 questions in 3 hours. That won't happen. Solve 3 hours paper. So in the first 2 attempts, I used to solve 7 questions per day, and that will not help because in per hour your frequency fluctuates, your efficiency fluctuates. So you should solve a complete 3-hour paper. Don't solve 7 questions or so. Other thing, what you should do is you should understand the question in the terminology of the question. For example, if there is a discuss or critically analyze or analyze, elaborate, so you should be able to understand this. And there is a very good write-up about this in the Vision IS. So you should read that and focus upon these key keywords. Now coming to division of the answers. So there is introduction, then there are multiple sections like positive, negatives, and the suggestions, and then there is a conclusion. So you should write all these things and try to incorporate it. If you are short of time, make diagram and write the points around it. That will also help you. So that will, like, I used to write as many points as possible if I feel it is relevant to this question. Because that will give a perception to the examiner that this person knows this much. And I try to incorporate another dimension to the question so that examiner will get another perception or another dimension of the question that, yes, the person is aware of other part of the question. And also it will give you an edge over the other answers because you have added another dimension of the question. For example, what government is doing, or what else we can do, what the international organizations are doing, try to incorporate it. Also, after you write your test, also I used to read the topper's copy at the Vision IS platform. So read topper's copy of every test. Students never read topper's copy because they think it's a waste of time, but I can promise you this is not a waste of time. You'll get a very good feeling that, okay, this answer can be written in this manner. So you can learn representation skill from the topper's copy. There is a section on the Vision IS platform from where you can get the topper's copy. Do read those copies, do read those essays and all. That will help you a lot. And write every day. Don't skip any day, or if you want, you can write alternate day, but write for 3 hours, continuous. Don't write for 1 hour and extrapolate it for 3 hours. Now, if you are analyzing your answer by yourself, you should be very brutal. Be brutal in analyzing your answer, and you should say like, oh, I could have write this answer rather than this answer. So be very strict while you are checking your answer. It applies to every paper, essay or ethics or any paper. And apart from this, I would say I always have 3 quotes written in my room, which helped me in gaining motivation. Because I also suggested this strategy to my friends, but they were saying that this is very harsh strategy. We are not able to follow it. So I used to have 3 quotes in my room, which I want to share with you. I think they might help you. So one was, the pain of discipline is far less than the pain of failure. So if you are very disciplined, that will give you a less pain, then you are a failure. At the time of mains result, if your roll number is not in the PDF, the pain of that is very, very, very large. Then the pain you will, then the pain you will get while you are following your daily schedule. So don't be laggard, and don't procrastinate your things. Do them as scheduled. That will be less painful, and also your family members will be will suffer less pain when you will follow the discipline. So do this. The next thing is, the Confucius said once, he who thinks he can and he who thinks he can't are both usually right. So so you should have this belief that I can do this, I can become an IAS officer. If you are not believing you, then it's not very a good sign, and you may not become an IAS officer. So have this faith that yes, I can become an IAS officer, and you will become someday. I still remember after my second attempt, when I got failed in mains, I used to get this thought that IAS is not for me, my cup of tea, and I will not be able to crack this exam. There are people who are very different who crack this such exam. So I should now skip and divert to some other areas. But then there is a thought comes to my mind that he who thinks who can and he who thinks who can't are both usually right. So have faith and have belief that you can do this and you will do this. Just work hard. And third thing, I think this will help. If you plan to follow your failure, if you fail to follow your plan, then you plan to follow failure. So I think this was the third quotation which I wrote. If you fail to follow plan, then you plan to follow failure. So make your plans and follow them very, very strictly, so you will succeed. This was all about my strategy. I hope it's clear to you. Thank you. Any questions? If
survivor.
Sorry?
Survivor, we can't.
Interview. Okay, for interview, I think one thing worked for me, that was the mirror practice. Do mirror practice every day, and that will help you a lot. That will remove your all hesitations and everything. And question yourself. And what I used to do is, I used to ask very uneasy questions to myself. Uneasy in the sense that, for example, why I came to civil services? If I have done this, why I am still coming to civil services? I will do corruption if I come to civil services. So these kind of uneasy questions, if you ask yourself, your truly personality will come out, and that will help you a lot. Remove your hesitations and everything, and discuss with your friends, discuss current affairs, everything. So that will help you in the interview. And don't be very nervous. So interview is very relaxed, calm environment. They will just ask very good questions, and the board is very cordial.
No.
My optional was anthropology.
From a engineering background and coming from triple IT as well, didn't you think about taking a science option like physics?
Yeah, I thought about taking a science optional like maths, but I was doing my post-graduation when I started this journey of UPSC. So I didn't have much time, so I took anthropology because it was short, and I think I could cover it in within span of 3 months. So I took anthropology.
Well, in your previous mains as well?
Yes, in anthropology I scored like all through very decent marks, 250 plus. For? I'll discuss with you because I think there are people who... It's okay.
A very warm welcome to all of you. My name is Sahil Gupta. I'm ranked 19th in this year's civil service examination. This has been my third attempt. My background is, I come from Haryana, Jhajjar district in Haryana. I graduated from VIT University in the year 2013. I'm a civil engineer by training. My interests and hobbies are watching and playing football and reading poetry at times when I get times. So today we will be talking about civil service, how to crack this examination, because there are so many myths around this examination. I think the first thing that we need to keep in mind while preparing for this examination is consistency, and we do not lose momentum while preparing for the exam. As my colleague has talked about, he has mentioned all the books that we need for the prelims examination. I will be primarily talking about essay and ethics in details. But before that, I would like to tell you about my journey, how my journey has been. My journey started in the year 2013, rather I would say 2012. It was the fourth year of my college when I started, when I decided that I should be sitting for this examination. So I dropped out of the placements. I didn't sit for the placement. I decided to get all the NCERTs. I started preparing at that point of time. I covered the basic books, these like Lakshmikant, Bipin Chandra, and all these books. I started preparing at the college level, but I gave my first attempt in the year 2014. I scored decent. I got through the prelims because at that time there was CSET. I scored very decently in CSET. I got through mains, but I couldn't get through interview. I scored very less marks in interview. My marks in interview were at that point among the lowest of that attempt, because I scored only 110 out of 275. Because my interview got really bad, I got really nervous, and it seemed to me that when I have come this far, coming to the interview stage and yet not able to qualify, I was a little heartbroken. But then I decided, okay, life is not over, we have to move on. So I decided to move on. In my second attempt, again I got through prelims, but I missed the mains by 6 or 7 marks. This has been a third attempt, and I am able to secure a good rank, a fair rank, 19. Now I would like to talk about GS mains, because he has already talked about GS prelims in detail. So my strategy for GS mains was, I prepared what I call my own files. First of all, what you need to do is you need to go through the syllabus. Just take a printout of the syllabus, write it on an A4 sheet, and stick it on your walls. So that first of all, you need to remember the syllabus, because whatever piece of information that you are going to read, you must be able to know where to apply that information. So what I did was, I prepared these files. When you start, it takes a lot of time to read newspaper. It may take 2 hours or 3 hours, but gradually when you will prepare your own notes, it depends on you whether you want to prepare handwritten notes or you want to use Evernote or whatever other application that is present. I preferred handwritten notes because of that I was able to recall things more easily. They come to me naturally since I was practicing and writing and making my own notes on a very daily basis. Now if we talk about GS, then primarily it has two parts. One is the static portion. Your static portion will be covered from your NCERTs. But for the dynamic portion, you have to go for newspapers and magazines. So I primarily used to follow the Hindu, and for magazine I used to read only Yojana and Frontline at times when I used to find that there has been something good that has been coming in Frontline. So I used to follow it at times. Plus the Vision IS current affairs material, because it is a very concise one. I used to make notes out of that material as well, and I used to compile all these things into the files that I have created, which I have built up over a period of time. When it comes to newspaper reading, I must say that when you will start, it will take time, but don't lose hope. Just keep going. You will realize after some time that you are getting more familiar with the topics, your notes are getting more updated, and you will be able to deal with the topics that comes in the mains, which are dynamic nature, in a more easy and relaxed manner. Because when you will be writing mains, there won't be any time. There will be only 3 hours, and you have to attempt 20 questions. So you need to be very well drilled in order to attempt those 20 questions. If you're not well drilled, if you don't have all the material in your mind, then there's no time there to just go and think. You have to be well drilled. Your material must be there. You must be able to recall it quickly and write it down. Plus, now I would like to talk about, all of you must be knowing that all the four papers of GS are 240 marks each. I would now like to talk about your paper GS4, which is Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude. Now in this paper, how many of you have you seen the syllabus for this paper? Anyone has seen the syllabus for this paper? Okay. So if you see the syllabus, then there is primarily 6 or 7 parts in the syllabus. One is your attitude, which talks about your thoughts and behavior, then your ethics and values, then your emotional intelligence, then the moral thinkers and the philosophers that's come, and then your ethics in public administration. There are some certain technical terms in here, probity, citizen charters, what is the difference between code of ethics and your code of conduct. These are very technical terms that you must be aware. So my source again was it was lexicon, because lexicon provided a very good insight. All the words, the meaning of all the words were very clearly mentioned, and you must be able to identify what is the difference. What is the difference between ethics and values? What is the difference between morality and ethics? You must be very familiar with these terms. And then the second part is your case study. So for case study, I think 7 case study comes in the exam, and each is, I guess, 20 marks, so it becomes 140 marks straight away. So while attempting I got 125 in ethics, which is a very decent score. So my strategy was, I attempted paper from the back. I went to the case study section first, because that is more of an analytical nature, where you have to analyze what is already given. So for that, you need to practice a lot. And for that, you can join Vision IS test series as well, because I think they provide very good and concise answers, where the questions are of more of analytical nature. Then, moving forward, in case study, the way you attempt it, I think first you need to, when you will be writing a case study, I used to always write it in first person, like I or we, using the first person pronoun. Second, what we used to, we need to identify in a case study that what is the ethical dilemma here, that which two values are at stake. For example, there can be such a case study where privacy as well as security, these two can be on a collision course, and then we need to find a right and fine balance between these two while writing. Also, while you will be preparing for your, also in case studies, you need to use the thinkers and the philosophers. Like we can use thinkers and philosophers like Gandhi, Ambedkar, Kant, Socrates, Aristotle. And since my option is political science and international relations, so I have borrowed very heavily from that option as well while preparing for my ethics paper. Now coming back to the after completing the case studies, coming back to the question sections, I would say your focus, all the thinkers and administrators, we must study in detail. For example, you can make very short notes on various administrators like M.S. Swaminathan, Homi J. Bhabha, Varghese Kurian, Vinod Rai, E. Sridharan. I made very concise notes, and wherever I have to give examples on them, examples on good administrative steps that have been taken, I gave these examples. This is about ethics. Now we'll talk a little about essay. So in essay, I have scored this time 164 marks. My essay journey has been a little up and down. It has been a little crust and rough, because in my first attempt I got 142. I hardly wrote any one or two essay before going into the mains. So I thought, okay, since I have scored well in the first attempt, I will surely do well in the second attempt. But in the second attempt, I scored 90 marks only, which was very low at that point of time. So I decided, no, that I need to do more practice. I need to write a lot. So then I decided to join a test series, and I wrote 4 or 5 essays this time, I've secured fairly good marks. Now in essay, what we need to do, the first thing is, I think the first paper, that you're going to write will be of essay. And essay is one such paper where you can express yourself very freely. You need not be afraid. Your language has to be crisp and simple, and you have the freedom to express yourself whatever you feel like. Now, the main thing is each section will have four options, and there will be two sections, and each essay will be of 125 marks with 1200 words each. So now what we will do is, first of all, we need to identify the correct essay. The general perception is, if I write a essay on a separate topic or which is a different one, then I will secure more marks, which is, I think, is actually a myth, because you must identify the essay which you are most comfortable with, on which you have content, on which you think you can express yourself very well. Second, when you look at the question paper, there will be, I guess, what happened with me was, I got confused between two essays, two topics. One, this time I wrote on, in the section A, I wrote on, if development is not engendered, it will be endangered. This was one of the essays. And second, I wrote on cybersecurity. So in the first one, I looked at the question paper, and straight away I crossed down the two. After four, I crossed down the two that I will not attempt these two. So out of the two, I got to the back of my paper. I scribbled a little. I wrote down all the content that I can generate at that point of time, and then I started writing. So what you can do, the general problem with people is they think that they don't feel comfortable like how to start an essay. So what I did this time around is I made a separate small notebook for quotes, where I divided that if a political essay will come, I wrote 10 quotes for that, and I hardly remember 2-3 out of those 10. Similarly, if a science essay will come, these are my 10 quotes, I will use them. If an economic essay will come, or a philosophical one will come, these are my 10 ones, and I will juggle them up and do my thing. Then we can also look up to, we can quote everyday examples into essays. For example, I remember in my home district, the government has used active trackers to control the female feticide or to increase the child sex ratio. So this was a step which has been taken 2 years back, because the district from where I came from has a very drastic sex ratio of around 750 or 760. And now it has reached 900 mark this year itself, child sex ratio at birth. So the administration used active trackers, where if there is an ultrasound machine, if it is misused, then it is connected and will send a message to the CMO, who can take the required action under PCPNDT. So such kind of examples I mentioned in my essay. Next is, you can use your data to supplement your essay. Like, for example, the essay which I wrote, I quoted data from HDI as well as GII, that because of the inequality, the gender inequality, there has been a 29% economic loss to our GDP. So I mentioned that as well, because whenever you are right, there must be some facts behind that. So I tried to mention to supplement that with my own facts. Then coming to the language must be very simple. You need not go for any. The language must be crisp and simple. Then the next thing is, what we do we divide our essay into various sections, and there must be organic interlinkages within your sections. For example, the one I wrote, it talked about the keywords in that were development and gender. So I started with the quote of Simone de Beauvoir, who said that sex is natural, gender is social, differences are natural, but discrimination is social. So this is how I started my essay. And then moving forward, I defined development. I defined like how the paradigm of development is evolving in itself. Like a 20 years down the drain, we were looking at the idea of economic development. Now in the 21st century, we are more talking about the idea of sustainable development. Then I defined development from the perspective of a common man. You can imagine, like, for a common man, what would development be? So I talked about public service delivery, because what would a common man want? He would want his sadak, pani, bijli at nominal cost. This is what he would want. Then I linked it with the second half of my essay, and I wrote, what if this development is not endangered? What are the losses that we might suffer if in case the development is not related to your gender empowerment? So I wrote all about the health issues. I related it with the education sector, with the social security, with safety of women. I wrote on all those topics. Then also I related it with the left wing insurgency, with the insurgency in Jammu and Kashmir and Northeast. So I made all these things that I mentioned. Then you can also use quotes while interlinking. Like, for example, I mentioned that Einstein has stated that imagination is more important than knowledge. So I mentioned it. There was one more of Helen Keller who said, keep your face to the sunshine and you won't see the shadows. So these quotes you can use while changing your paragraphs to give it a more classical flow while writing an essay. Then in the essay part itself, then I talked about what we normally do. I took the political, economic, social, psychological, behavioral. I took all these aspects and I wrote on them. Then I talked about what if there will be gender equality. I created an imaginary situation, and then I talked about it, where I talked about it. If the woman is empowered and educated, then the democratic structure, the justice delivery, sustainable development, as well as there will be a grassroots revolution that can take place. So while writing, you can borrow very heavily from newspapers, from Yojana, or the data and the content will automatically come from your GS papers. This all what you can do for essays. Don't forget to do one thing while writing an essay, and that is make sure that you tie up the loose ends. Because what we do in essays, we ask a lot of questions. We tend to ask a lot of questions. That in my essay, I ask questions like, what if development is not engendered? What will happen then? What if it gets engendered? How will we make it engendered? How there will be women equality? So all these questions that I'm asking, I must try and provide a solution to all these problems. So I tried to do that at my best. Then you can also quote examples from the history. Like I quoted example of Sarojini Naidu and Kumari Sarla Devi from the history. So you can also borrow from history as well. You can borrow from present situation. I also related it with globalization and its impact, where I mentioned about Indra Nooyi, Sheryl Sandberg, and give contemporary examples to make my essay more effective. Finally, at the end, what you need to do is don't end essay on a pessimistic note. Always end it on a positive note that there is hope for improvement. Because what I did in my second attempt, the essay that I wrote gave a sense of being anti-establishment. It gave a sense of being a pessimistic essay in nature. And that is why I realized that I've scored such low marks in essay. So while writing essay, just make sure that the essay has a very positive vibe about it. Then coming to the final part of interview, I have attended two interviews. This was my second interview. My interview was on first day. One suggestion I would like to give you, if you write your mains very well, then don't take a long break, because this is the mistake which I did in my first attempt. My mains examination went fairly well, and then I took a break of about 1 or 2 months, because of which I lost momentum and I couldn't get back into the flow. So don't take a long break. Just keep continuing your preparation. If you are from this near Delhi region, then your interview will come very early, within the first or second week itself. So you might not get a month or 2 months to prepare. So keep your preparation handy. Also, don't panic in the interview, because I panicked in my first interview. I got so panicked that I was not able to reply a very simple question like why president is a part of parliament. And because of such because of not able to handle pressure and panicking at that point of time, I scored such low marks. So my strategy would be like, be confident, just be yourself, fill in the gap with honesty, don't fake anything, just be yourself while filling the gap, because that will form the basis of your interview. While answering questions, there will be times in the interview when they will try to check your confidence level. So like with me, while I was replying to the international questions, there came a time when they told me that you should not have taken this optional, you should not have taken this subject as your optional. But at that point of time, I felt like it came as a shock from them. But then I just kept going. I tried to answer all the questions to the best of my capabilities, and I scored a decent 165 marks, and plus my mains marks of 904, total to 1069, and I got this 19th rank. If there are any queries, then I would be happy to take it. I took coaching from Shubhra ma'am, Shubhra Ranjan ma'am. I totally relied on the notes. For international relations sections, I did newspaper and newspaper and a little bit of world focus. That's it. I think if you will read newspaper very honestly, make notes out of it, makes note out of Yojana, because if you see Yojana, one topic like health or education, if you are reading it sensibly, it has 10 or 12 articles in it. So your whole health and education or whatever sector is that gets completed. If you make note out of it, you don't have to go to multiple sources. So don't make this mistake of going to multiple sources. Just stick to one source, which you think is the best, which is reliable for you. And that's it, I think. You need to net very extensively. Just search down all the things, make very small notes. Because what I used to do, I used to make a lot of notes. I didn't use online, but make notes online. I used to note it down myself. And then at the end of it, I used to make small notes out of those notes. So this is how I did.
You scored well in the optional in all three?
No. I scored drastically during my second attempt. This time I scored 270, which is a decent score. I scored very badly during the second attempt, somewhere around 188. So these have fluctuated. When you don't write exams, when you don't practice, you're bound to suffer. This is the reality. And you have to just, consistency is the key word. Just keep working hard. Don't think about the end result. The moment you start thinking about, am I good enough to make it? Or, because like till 30th of May, I was also preparing for my fourth attempt. It is after the result that you get into this feeling that, oh, now we have become IAS. But IAS is not like anybody having this super intellectual entitlements. Nobody's like this. I'm a very average student. I've scored 75.8% marks in my 12th class. So just be it. Just go for the exam. Keep preparing. Keep working hard. And leave the result on God. He will take care of it. When you will read, I think, 10 to 12 articles, I think there will be 6 to 7, which will primarily of much use. If you find a good clipping of a good diagram, say in environment there comes a whole list of SDGs, your sustainable development goals come in, you cut that off, paste it on. Then new schemes are coming. You read, you find some good data, jot it down. You find some good point where environment is related to women, or how sustainability is related to accessibility, or how interlinkages have been formed, just note them down one by one. And this is how you can prepare the notes. It will take time, but don't go for multiple sources then. Once you note it down at one point of time, at one place, then just stick to it. Rely on it 100%, it will do for you. Sorry? Yeah, leave for the last month, I guess. Like if the exam this time was in December and I read till November. Internal security, I read Vision IAS notes. And search on internet, there's so much material. What you can do is, you can imagine the map of India, then you can see like in Northeast, which are the states that we have problem, which are the states in which we have insurgency, what are the groups, what are the problems, arms, drug trafficking, all these problems. You know what are the problems with Pakistan, try to know the problems with Nepal, with China, make separate notes like country-wise. That will be a big, that will help you when you will be writing mains, because What happens that when you are writing mains, there are 9 papers, 2 qualifying in 7, whose marks are going to count it, and they will be back to back, and you will not get any time for revision. So make sure you have all your material with you, which you are going to write, and you are well drilled up and well practiced. Sorry, ma'am. No, ma'am, I did not, because I find, because it, like, a newspaper is sufficient. And if there's anything that I thought I need to study, I used to go on internet and study it from there.
When should one start the preparation for essay? Like, which is the best time to do so?
Ma'am, today is the best time, I would say.
And how should one go about it? Like, just start writing about any topics that from the previous year?
Yeah, ma'am, just pick up the previous year papers and see what are the topics. You might not be knowing, have information or content about all the 8 topics that are given. Pick the one that you are most familiar with. You think that, okay, this is what I knew something about it. Try and write it. Give it to your friends. They will review it. They will review the language as well as the content. Because what we are often confused is, which is more important? The language is more important or the content is more important? I think both are equally important. We need to emphasize equally on both of these to score good marks in essay. Revision plan, keep revising. I did not have like a specific plan. On weekends, on Sunday, I used to sit and I used to revise whatever I studied in the previous 6 days. This was my plan, very simple. Maybe maybe your essay then was more about schemes. I mentioned schemes, but in a very limited space. Say I devoted 2 paragraphs to schemes and what are their impacts. You also need to include what are the concepts related to women. Like Amartya Sen has given a concept of missing women, that our women are missing from the electoral democracy, that since they are not able to participate, we don't have gender equity. The moment they will get their political rights, they will eventually get economic equality over a due course of time. I mentioned 2-3, but we can talk after what I've written. There's no problem. I'll tell you in detail what all I've written.
And we can include diagrams also in the essay, like, is it justified?
That depends on the nature of essay that has been asked. I would not say to draw diagrams, I would not say.
Number of hours you study?
The most difficult question, bro. So I never had this thing of studying for hours, like for going for hours, like 10, 12 hours, never. I used to set my target, like if this is one notebook or one book that I have to complete, then I used to give myself 2 days or 1 day. Whatever target I have in my mind, I then used to finish it in that day itself, in that deadline. I used to set deadlines rather than hours, because that is more suitable, that keeps you on fire, like, okay, I have to complete this. Yes, please.
Which month we start for current affairs for mains, and to which month?
I think when you will be for mains, the last 3 months, like just before the exam, will be crucial. Study the rest of it as well, but the last 3 months will be very crucial. Don't miss anything from those. This is like my experience from the past 3 mains.
So I think so he's referring to the prelims portion.
Prelims portion study for the 12 months, entire 12 months.
So how can choose the optional subject?
For choosing optional, I would say, first of all, you go and search all the previous year's papers. Like when I have to choose my optional, I remember I was confused between political science and history. So what I did was, I took down the new question papers, then I saw the material that is available, what are the coachings that are available, because you also need to consider that fact in your mind as well. Then I bought some basic books, like one basic book I bought for each of the subject. I read it, I felt, okay, political science is more comfortable because I'm more comfortable reading international relation, so I took political science. So this is the way that you can do, I think so. Newspapers say notes. This is a very tedious exercise, to be very frank, because what I did is, I prepared files for this. Like you take a file, make daily notes out of newspaper, whichever you think are important, leave the political news aside. फॉर एग्जाम्पल अभी GST आ रहा है या कुछ और भी आ रहा है, तो यू जस्ट नोट इट डाउन, आप करते जाइए उसको धीरे धीरे, इवेंचुअली वो 2-3 महीने बाद यू विल हैव सफिशिएंट अमाउंट ऑफ GST, सफिशिएंट अमाउंट ऑफ कंटेंट ऑन GST, दे कीप रिवाइजिंग इट। और सबसे पहले आप जब फाइल बनाए तो मेक एन इंडेक्स ऑफ इट, दैट इज वाई से दैट सिलेबस इज मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल गो एंड रीड द सिलेबस दैट हैज बीन प्रोवाइडेड बाय UPSC, बिकॉज दैट इज लाइक प्रीएम्बल ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन फॉर यू पीपल, जस्ट लर्न इट स्ट्रेट अवे, एंड देन like whatever information that has been coming in newspaper, that is just a piece of information. You must be knowing how to apply it, and that application will part only comes with experience.
Sir, which books is sufficient for both sides?
Which book? Yeah, I read only O.P. Goba, and that too for reference. Like if there's a definition I'm not clear about, if there's a concept I'm not able to get, I used to go to books. Otherwise, I stick to ma'am's notes. For international relation, yes, I read very extensively. I read from, I used to read C. Rajamohan articles. You can search them on net. Then Hindu is very good source. Suhasini Heather. Then if you keep reading, then there will be some writers you will develop a taste towards. So this happened with me, and this is how I went about it. Topic-wise. And try to make a file, because what happens is when we make notes in a notebook, we are not able to update it. Some are in this notebook, others are in this notebook, and your main's coming up, and you don't know where what is, and it will be all messed up.
So there are a lot of articles and everything is there in the newspaper and the magazines when you are making notes out of it. So how do you really decide that which information has to be noted down and which is?
That is why I am saying that please read the syllabus part first, because if you read the syllabus part, you will have greater clarity about which information to include and which to leave. Like, remove all the political news. Which politician is saying what, doing what, just leave it. What are the good schemes, initiatives, analysis? Because focus more on analysis. Read the 2 editorials that come, because they are the most important part of the newspaper.
Sir, do we need to read the non-fictional books like you mentioned about Amartya Sen's missing
book? I did read during my college. I read The Argumentative Indian, and I read India After Gandhi, Ramchandra Guha. These were the 2 books I read during my 4th year when I had time and I was doing my BTech final year project. At that point of time, if you think you have time, then you can read. There's no compulsion that like you have to read. It is simply depends on your time management and if you have time.
Nowadays, there's a lot of hue and cry regarding Indian Express and Hindu. And a lot of people say that you should go for both.
I primarily relied on the Hindu. I, during my interview time, I tried to go for Indian Express as well, but then I realized that I'm not able to like do justice to both of them. I developed a habit of reading Hindu over a period of 2 years, so I thought that no, I was not very happy reading Express. So whatever you are happy with, whatever you are comfortable with, read one among the two. That is your personal decision.
Part A of ethics paper is static or dynamic?
Sorry?
Part A of ethics paper is static or dynamic?
Part A. If you will see the syllabus, you will see that it is static, but the questions they will ask are of dynamic nature. For example, in ethics paper, I remember I was reading one article newspaper where it was like there was 2 officers that have been inducted in the Delhi Commission of Women, and they were acid victims. Now these were the 2 officers that will attend the victims who will come over. So what will happen is, if say I am an acid attack victim and I am going to register the complaint, and if I see that the other person is also a victim, obviously she will show more empathy towards me, and there will be what I would say the grievance redressal mechanism, there will be no clogging in that. So I found that as a very good step, and I mentioned that in my ethics paper, that these are some of the steps that we can do or I can take as an administrator. Yeah, I have read a little bit of Iqbal. Nahi tera nashe man kasr sultani ke gumbat par, tu shahi hai basera kar pahadon ki chattano. Any other questions? Yeah, I have made notes for everything. This has been my mantra. Maybe I've got a result after 4 years, but it has paid results, and it will pay you good dividends, trust me. So make result, make your short notes. Don't just borrow notes from your friends. Make your own notes, work hard, just simple.
sir, there are sources, online sources for Hindu analysis. Sir, we need to go for that or need to read the whole newspaper.
Why won't you want to read the original stuff, man? Just read the original stuff. No, if you are facing any problem in the analysis part, then you can go. But if you're finding that, I think if you will read Hindu for 2-3 months, you will find it very legible. Okay, haan ho jayega. So I would say go to the original stuff, stick to it.
Sir, are there any tips to make notes?
No. Keep writing. Any other question?
Sir, how did you cover the theory and thinkers part of political science?
Theory and thinkers? I scored 125 in this year and I still think I'm very weak in that part. If I get a chance to rewrite mains, I would work on that part. But for that part also, I relied on Shubhra ma'am notes completely. I read OP Goba once. I used to use it as a dictionary, like if I have any doubt in a certain section, say democracy or justice, then I used to refer it. Otherwise, I relied on ma'am's notes. That did for me.
Sir, two questions.
Yeah.
So, were you taking any coaching in any institute?
I took a lot of coaching too. Sorry?
Is there study material sufficient to clear prelims?
It is? Is there?
Is there study material provided by the institutes sufficient to clear prelims?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Easily. Prelims, for prelims, you need to focus on NCERTs, newspapers, and you can pick any one current affair booklet from the market, whichever you wish to.
About
CSAT? CSAT sold 5 or 5 papers before the exam, that's it. I think we need to score only 66 marks out of 200, up greater than 66. I think that will help. You can do that with 4 or 5 papers. Ma'am, I did BV Rao for World History. Plus, I also refer to the Vision IAS. There are 2 booklets. One is, I think, starts from World War I, and the other is before that. I refer to the second one because I find the first one, there's a lot more to study, so I skip that. Any other questions? Thanks a lot. Exactly the way you have told yourself. First, read the portion, whatever it has been given in the syllabus. Like if the first 10 chapters are coming, I would read them. Then I would go to solve the paper. Yeah, yeah. When you're beginning, it is good to cover it subject-wise. But once you are like 1 month or 2 months before the prelims, go for the comprehensive papers because that is what will come in the examinations. Any other? Okay, thanks a lot. Thank you for the session.
Very good morning to all of you. Am I audible? Okay. So I'm Abhilash Mishra. Somehow I have got rank 5 this time. So since this is a somehow, I'll like to say at the starting that I did not plan a strategy when I prepared. So if I start telling a strategy of mine right now, I'll be making it up. So basically, from my side, it will be experience sharing. This was my 4th attempt. I gave my first attempt in 2013, failed in mains. 2014, I got through in the list, 518 rank. I got in IRTS. Then in my 3rd attempt, I got a rank of 341. I got in customs. Right now, I'm in customs only. And this year, I've got the 5th rank. So this is the UPSC journey that I had. One thing, I'll start from something very general. I was talking to sir. So one of the phenomena that we have seen in UPSC is that a large percentage of students who are getting selected are professionals. They already have a job. They have a job experience. So first, let me say that I started my preparation when I was in Indian Oil Corporation. So online platforms right now, in fact, Vision IS also is promoting online online study material and all in a big way. So that is helping. Specifically for those people who are in job and who feel that they are at a loss because they do not have access to good faculty and material. For example, somebody may be working in Gujarat and Maharashtra and they will find it difficult to come to Delhi because they will not have the they will not have enough leave. So these digital platforms, many of which are coming, are helping them. And the pattern of examination that is fast changing. I think this is an era of examination where if you consistently study for 5-6 hours self-study, that is more than enough. But that should be on a consistent basis. For those in job, it is also a very good thing that is coming up. You can have a job, you can prepare. In that sense, you also have a fallback plan, and need not feel that you are at loss with those who are preparing in Delhi. And yes, they should also prepare well with the material that is available. Okay, next thing is since it was my fourth attempt, I'd like to share that the earlier speakers Himanshu and Sahil were third attempts. So this was my fourth attempt. I'll say that not all of us can get success in the first attempt itself. Though many of them they must be very brilliant, but there is an element of luck and a sort of UPSC trend that is there in this examination. So you can't beat it. For example, if you see this year pattern, I'll say that law is an optional which has been brought down. It is hard to imagine that all the students of the law were that bad that they scored so much low marks in their optional. So there's a UPSC trend. So even if you don't succeed in the first attempt, do not get disheartened, do not get demotivated. Continue as Himanshu was saying, believe in yourself, have confidence, and pursue with your preparation. I said there is a UPSC trend, but since you can't do anything about it, just keep preparing hard and believe that luck will be on your side in one of your attempts, which I think was on my side this attempt. So you will succeed. That's the first thing, that keep pursuing your dream, keep preparing, even if you face instances of failure. Okay, Himanshu was telling about pre. I like to add something to it. He told about the basic preparation, and Sahil also referred to some of the portions. I like to say that once you have prepared the syllabus for pre, the real challenge is its execution. They said that yes, practice is very much necessary. I used to practice test papers. One thing that is there, that once you go in the examination, even if the best of the preparation in prelims, I found that in the first go, there will be like 45-50 questions at the most on which you can say that you are 100% sure. So that will land you around say 100 marks. And with the cutoff that we are seeing, it is not possible to clear the prelims with 100 marks. So how can you increase the probability of you clearing mains? This is how your study and your knowledge will come in handy here, and all the different materials, the digging up of dirt that is required in prelims you have done, because now you need to take some sort of guess in various questions. You need to eliminate certain options, and if you are confused between say two options, you need to go with your hunch and what you have read, that okay, this will be your answer, because in some questions guess will be required. So elimination of options and guessing in some instances, not all, will be helpful in increasing your attempt and hence increasing your chances of qualifying prelims. So this was the implementation part that I would like to add. We discussed what we all need to speak. So I was given two important topics that I'll speak on, from the society, the GS paper 1, and security portions from GS paper 3. So firstly, moving to GS paper 3 security portion, many people ask that how to study security. So the thing is that I read a book, I am unable to recall its name. It's from a senior IPS officer. It's Internet Security Challenges. The book is heading like that, International Security Challenges in India. What this book does is that it gives a brief, it provides you a brief outlook over all the security issues that are there in India. the different regions, their problem, for example, the cyber, maritime security, nationalism, all. It gives you a sort of perspective on as to how you should understand the security issues. So once you have read this book and you are aware about the basics and the historical aspects of security challenges in India, you will understand your current affairs in a more appropriate manner. Once you read the current news related to nationalism, you will relate to the basics that you have read, and it will aid on to your knowledge of, say, nationalism and security challenges related to it. So in this way, if you have read this basics, and you can add on to with the current affairs, and then there are certain very good sites. For example, there's a site IDSA. So it provides very good write-ups on securities. Good perspective on security and as to how you should deal the different angles of it. I also have read the security notes provided by Vision IS, and it is also very good notes because it gives security dimensions of like very political, social, economic from different angles. So if you cover from these 2 to 3 sources, I think you can cover your international security portion very well. But while you are attending international security questions in the examination, one thing is very important. Do not just approach it from a single, one perspective. Try to include all the, what will be the economic angle of the security, strategic, even if you can add the geographical perspective. So that will give a wider, as I said in the preparation, if you have studied the basic, you can provide a wider perspective of the security challenges, and it will improve your marks in this section. It can improve basically your marks in this section. Another important thing related to security is that since most of the, from the GS3 and GS2, most of the questions come from current affairs. So analyze the security news that are coming or the government actions that they are taking a little bit more than other things probably. Because the questions are generally on on expected lines that, okay, these are the security issues that are in news, and probably from that only the paper will come. So there are generally broadly, if you classify, there are 10 to 12 issues that are there, and you can analyze them and go in a little depth and prepare your syllabus for this security thing. Specifically for society, I'll say that it is a very scoring portion, because there's a trend like almost six questions comes from there, so it's a good 75 marks from there. So what you need to do is go through the basic concepts of society. People read some books like Ram Ahuja. I have not read it, but people say it's a good book. But if you're not doing, I personally read the NCRT. And what it does, it you are aware of the basic concepts related to society, the poverty, population, women, gender, these sort of aspects, the basics you get cleared. And again, since most of the questions from society will come from the current affairs section. So the thing is that you should now again relate your basics to these happenings in the current affairs. And whenever a question is asked in the society, try to write some basics, which you probably have read from the NCRT, or some notes which you can refer to, and then give examples of the current happenings that you are seeing and relate to them. Another very important thing related to society, I'll tell you, there are very good government reports that come. Be it, say, Ministry of Women, Child and Development annual report, be it some, for example, there was a women, I'm unable to record the report, but there was a recommendations on how to improve the quality of women education. Then there are reports of general nature, for example, reports on education, which has something relevant for women. So try to collect from these reports and from these reports, government reports, and the commissions and committees that have been set up, and try to collect good amount of facts and data that is relevant to your society section. And another important thing for society is that I talked to some of the students who have sociology optional. They say that whenever they approach their paper 2, relatable to this GS1 section, they say that they present a lot of facts. So if a question is asked related to women, if a question is asked related to old age, so they will give. They'll start say India has this much percentage of old age people, and this is their problems, and these are the different facts related to women. This percentage of women face violence. Some striking facts, say UNESCO or some particular organization says that this much women are subjected to violence at this rate. So it provides your answer with a different perspective. It gives you an edge over other answers. by adding these facts and reports of committee and commissions, in addition to writing the basics as well as the current affairs. So if you combine all these things, probably you can tackle both the society as well as the security portion very well. Society, I think broadly, this is the thing. Another thing I would like to add is the thing on ethics, GS paper 4. Sahil has dealt it in a depth, but I like to add, say that you need to give some very practical examples while writing ethics papers, and do not make it a utopian analysis, I'll do this, I'll do that. Try to limit yourselves. For example, if you're giving suggestions for reform, and you say, like one of my teachers was telling me that if I have a problem in Bihar, in the municipal education system there. So, and I start giving suggestions that I'll, since teachers are not attending, I'll put up a biometric system, I'll put up CCTV cameras and monitor their movements and all. But is it a practical step? It is not, simply because there the crisis of funds is there. If you were at liberty or spending so much, probably the people there would have done so. So when you provide examples, when you give suggestions, try to give some practical suggestions. The example, I think whoever is checking copy will be happy that, okay, he has considered the limitations that we have. Government, most of the people in the government do try to do good things, but there are a scarcity of resources, scarcity of manpower. These are the things that you should consider while giving suggestions. Another thing is that when you are attending the ethics papers, do not limit yourselves to the GS4 syllabus. Try to bring in all the syllabus of GS, and probably what you have learned in your home and what you have learned in your education throughout up to this point. Suppose many of the students who are prolific answer writers in GS ethics paper, they quote Gita, which is not a syllabus, which is not our syllabus, but they have learned in home or probably at some other place. They quote it very effectively. What better moral lesson you can have than from Gita or from other religious books? And another thing is, they also bring in examples from day-to-day life, the current affairs thing, and they probably, many students I have seen, they refer stories from Panchtantra. So they have good moral lessons. So when you write your ethics paper, widening your horizon, and present examples from different aims, different walks of education that you have seen in your life, and also try to present some very specific and practical examples that are relevant to the context of the question. And do not write unnecessary examples that have no relevance with regards to the question that is that has been asked. So if you do it, it can help you in ethics paper. Another thing is that somebody asked about the theoretical portion of the ethics paper. So there are very good number of terms that have been provided there. Now somebody asked how much should be static and how much should be dynamic. The thing is that they ask the questions in an applied manner. For example, if in some questions would be that they'll quote a particular philosopher, say Lord, or say Swami Vivekananda, but they'll ask it in a manner that is having a contemporary application. So you need to write the basics of that quote, what was the context and probably what did it mean, and how it is relevant now. Because that is how it is relevant now is a more important facet of the question. And if you fail to address that part of the question, marks will go down, in my opinion. Because most of us will be knowing that quote, most of us will be knowing what it means. But how it is applicable in the current scenario and how it is helpful to get a moral lesson is more relevant in answering that question. So the questions may be of static natures, the quotes may be static, the philosophers may be dead now, but their applicability of the quotes and whatever teachings they have given is pretty much there. And you need to relate it and present your answers in that manner. If you go, give current examples or what you are reading in your current affairs and relate it with the quotes of the philosophers, it gives an understanding that you have actually understood the meaning of what that philosopher is trying to convey, and this correlation will help you score good marks. This is what I'd like to add in the ethics papers. Something in general about the answer writing. In my view, the presentation part in this examination is very much important, because when examiner is checking your copy, we are not there, and only our answers that we have written speak for us. So whatever knowledge we have will be hardly of any relevance if our answers don't speak for it. So the thing is that we should work a lot, as Himanshu was saying, that, and Sahil was also saying, that practice a lot, do a lot of test series, utilize your time well in writing, Because writing not only helps improve your answer writing skills, it also helps you revise your syllabus and remember it. In my opinion, when you write things, you remember it more. So the thing is that when you write more, your presentation skills will improve. You'll get comments from teachers that you are doing wrong with these things and this all. So your presentation skills will improve. As already said, try to use facts, figures, reports of different committee and commissions, government schemes that is related, and try to draw diagrams in whichever question it is possible. Specifically for paper, for the society section and the entire GS3 syllabus, especially the economic portion, the presentation of the facts and figures is an important thing because it provides a validation to what you are saying. We all can write good number of points on GDP and all in 2 pages that is there in the question sheets, in the question papers. But the thing is, if you can provide extra fact, if you can relate it to a scheme, it will give a sense of validation to what you are saying, and it will improve your marks in general. So the thing is that specifically for GS3 and society, dig up some facts, collect it topic wise for agriculture, for economy, and use it whenever you get a chance in your answer writing. And another thing is, whenever you are attending questions, say from geography, always try to draw a map. Suppose you are thinking that it is not relevant, but draw a map. Write something in the map itself. The reason why I am saying it so, because once you think it from an examiner perspective, he has to check 1,000 of copies, and all of them have been written in the same manner. Every copy is coming to them. So when you see a copy that has some difference, it attracts him or her. So if suppose the map has no relevance to the question that has been asked in the examination, draw a map of India and write some basic points there only. It gives a sort of edge towards the presentation that you are doing. And in my view, it can be helpful. Try that. But try that in the test series also, because if you think that you will do it only in the mains examination of civil services, it will be difficult, because it should be your practice. It should come automatically. So you should start experimenting with it in the test series only. If it is at the back of your mind, it will obviously help you. Another important thing is, while preparing, is that I should have said it in the starting, that always have the syllabus at the back of your mind. It will help in a manner that once you know all the different aspects of your syllabus, whenever you read your current affairs, it is very helpful. For example, if I read a newspaper, say that's Sahil was saying, he read Hindu, last year I read Indian Express, I am reading a newspaper, but and I am reading a news article. If I have the grasp for my syllabus, I can straight away say, okay, this article is relevant to this portion in the economy. This article is also relevant for this portion in the society. Okay, this article I can also use for quoting very good examples in ethics. So if you know your syllabus while you are studying your current affairs, it is very helpful in correlating. And it helps you remember your current affairs in a better manner. And it also helps you relate to the question that is being asked in the examination. If you just read your current affairs blindly without relating it to the different aspects of your syllabus, perhaps you will struggle in understanding and analyzing the questions that is being asked. Because if you read a news article from, for example, I'll give you an example of, say, geography. Geography is supposed to be very static, but over the few years, the geography questions have become very much dynamic. So let's say I have the syllabus at the back of my mind and I am reading the Delhi pollution problem. So I'll straight away relate to it, okay, it has a geographical angle. Delhi is bounded by many states that are burning some crop residues and because of which pollution is coming. And straight away you see in question in 2015 means that why Delhi is having more pollution compared to other metropolitan cities like Mumbai and Kolkata. So if you have like syllabus at the back of your hand, you'll be able to relate to it with it and probably present your answers in an effective manner. So first thing is that know your syllabus. This is true for both optional as well as GS papers. Your current affairs can also help you in options by relating to the different concepts in your optionals. And you can also give pretty much good examples from your current affairs. And once you start giving examples from your current affairs in whatever, in either the GS papers, essay, or the optionals, it gives an understanding that you have understood your concepts, your basics. Because only those who have understood the concepts and the basics can relate to it. And hence, it gives you an edge over others. So try to do it. I think it can be of help to you. Another important thing is, I like to add on, somebody asked how to choose an optional. Do not try to choose optional on the basis of UPSC trends, because generally some people I have talked to after this year results have come out, they say that this subject has done well this time, so should I take this as optional? I'll say that UPSC trend is a hard reality, but we cannot beat it. So if we start taking optionals according to UPSC trend, what will happen if, say, what will happen if the trend changes next time? We'll be struggling. So try to pick up a subject which has good material available, which has good guidance available, and which is suited to your interest, because that is very important. Again, I'll say I had PubEd, but this was my fourth attempt. Had I not had a little interest in PubEd, I would have straight away thought that let's change the optional. Though I very honestly say that I thought it many times during the last few years that I should change my optional, but somehow I didn't, and it has paid off this time. So choose an optional which is suited to your interest, which can be, which you can pursue even if you face failure in your first or second attempt, say, and for which good material and good guidance is available. For example, I'll particularly say that Hindi medium students are at a disadvantage because some of the good books that are written in English is not there. So in that sense, the quality of material is very important. You should have an optional which has good guidance, material, and obviously your interest. And choose your optional on your own. Do not ask others what optional should I choose. And as Sahil said, analyze the papers. You will each one of us are unique in a sense. They have particular inclinations. So if you read something, we read it in a different manner. For example, many of us closely relate to historical figures. They are more attracted to history. So each of us has a different perspective. So choose your own optional by analyzing the different papers that are there, the syllabus that is there, and whatever guidance and material is available in the market. I think this is all I'd like to say. Related to the government schemes, many of the things are coming from government schemes also these days. So the thing is, whenever you read a government schemes, try to ask some questions, that why this scheme has been brought, why it has been replaced, because some earlier scheme must have some lacuna or some weaknesses. Try to know that, and how can it be helpful in the current scenario, and what more can be done, as Sahil was referring to. When you are writing your answers, Himanshu was referring to when you are concluding. So when you study your government schemes and different current affairs using this perspective, why this is happening, what was the fault with the earlier approach, and how this can come as a change and be helpful, and what more can be done. You will study as to how you will be answering in your examination. So it straight away provides a link and improves your presentability and understanding of the topics. This was regarding what I would like to say. Any questions that any one of you would like to ask, please, I'll try to answer it. Yes, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Public administration, you'll be knowing that there are two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. I took guidance from Luqman IAS Salamuddin Ansari, sir. So that was my main source of study, but for the books, I'll say that it was Mohit Bhattacharya. There are four books of it. I think you know, knowing New Horizons, the social issues and perspective, social development, and restructuring public administration. So these are the four books that are there. Do not read the book topic by topic and page by page. When you are preparing your syllabus and you have read some particular thing, try to go to the book and read it. So in that way, it is more helpful. And many of the things of the public administration are a dynamic nature. So use net extensively for preparing public administration. There are some very good reports available, 15-20 page reports of World Bank and IMF. So that have very good administrative material. So it's a 15-20 page report, but there are 3-4 pages relevant for public administration. So you can use certain online material like these and compile it. It can be very helpful and give you an insight into what is the recent or current temporary development with regards to public administration. And for paper 2, I'll say there are a good number of books, Rajni Goel, Arora, for covering basics portion. Try to get good notes of paper 2. There are already good notes in it. For example, the Ansari's note is pretty good. And the thing is that you can, especially for paper 2, the government committees and commissions for administrative reforms, say ARC, then Mali Math Commission from criminal justice system, the Venkatachariya commissions and others becomes very much relevant, because once you quote these reports in your answers, once you associate the concepts or the topics given in the paper 2 syllabus for the Indian administration, it becomes you are presenting more facts and you are analyzing the questions more in an effective manner, better than probably others would do if they are not quoting reports. And one important thing, when you are writing answers in paper 1, do not try to limit yourselves to the Indian administration itself, because that is a theoretical portion. So when you are talking, for example, if a citizen charter question is asked in paper 1, which is a citizen charter is a topic in paper 1, you can't always limit your answers in Indian administration and say, okay, in India this is such a thing has been done. Try to go to the concept. First, try to explain the concept, basics, and what is happening in a global sphere. And if you want to add, provide examples from Indian administration also, because that is a theoretical portion and having a global implication. If you start limiting your paper 1 answers only to Indian administration, means you are not covering your answer. You are not giving holistic answers. There's a lot to talk about in public administration, but I think it will be a waste of time for class, because most of them will not have the public administration option. Anything else? Okay, so I've got like two online queries also. They are, again, the question is strategy for public administration. Mr. Alok Singh and Vikas Tandon has asked. Strategy for public administration, again, as I was talking to ma'am, that there are two papers, both are entirely having some different angles to them. So first thing is that try to read good books for paper 1. If you have like read Mohit Bhattacharya, probably you will not understand. In fact, I didn't understand in the first go. It is written in a little complex manner. But if you read it 2 to 3 times, probably you'll get grasps of the concepts and whatever meanings they are trying to give or explain. So read good books for paper 1. Do not only limit yourselves to the notes, because once you limit yourselves to the notes, you do not focus too much on the concept, and if the question comes outside of the note, it becomes difficult to tackle it. So read the basics from good books. That is the first thing. And also for paper 1 and for paper 2. Then the thing is that whenever you are writing public administration answers, same is true for GS also, try to relate the concepts, however old they may be, with the current happenings. For example, if I say that if you are talking about administrative reforms, if you are talking about O&M, these are some topics in public administration. Try to get examples like the coming of Niti Aayog, the removal of the planning commissions, and what little steps in administration, the biometric system that is being brought up, and what promotional changes have been done for the promotion and all by this government. So that provides a contemporary outlook to your answers, in addition to the basic that you have written. This will give a contemporary perspective to the answers. Another thing for public administration is that try to link. For example, if you're writing answers in paper 2, say minister civil servant relationship. And if you can relate to this topic with some thinkers of the paper 1, it gives an indication that you have understood the subject in a holistic manner. You are relating different aspects of the questions or different aspects of the syllabus. In many ways it can be done. For example, Taylor, Weber, that are thinkers in paper 1, have very can be applied in paper 2 in a large scale. So this sort of linkages of thinkers of various topics of paper 1 with paper 2 in questions that is being asked can help you build up your answers. And do a lot of practice in answer writing, because do not write all the things that you know about the concept. Write what has been asked in the questions. The thing is that public administration sometimes leaving aside this year paper, sometimes the questions are so complex that we don't understand what they are asking. I still remember in 2015 we were sitting in the exam, the question paper came, all of us were having public administration, we were sitting in that room, so we all saw each other and laughed. Is this public administration paper? But this was how the trend was. So even if there are some questions like that, there will always be some questions which are known to you. So my teacher says that focus on the questions which you know and write as good answers as possible for those which are you entirely sure. For example, even if 250 marks paper is there and 160, 170 marks you know. So you attempt your 160, 170 marks very, very honestly and very, very efficiently so that you maximize your score. And for the remaining 80 marks questions or say 5 to 6 questions, try to write some basics. You must be understanding some part of the questions, if not all. To try to write that part of the questions and give some examples related to the questions that is being asked. Try to cover it in a manner so that you attempt it also and do not write wrong things. You may not be knowing the exact answer, but write something that is not wrong. In that way, you can attempt the entire paper. You can, since you have attempted the portion you know in an efficient manner, you will maximize your score. Because that was the thing till last year. I still remember the paper 250 marks, so I only knew around 180 marks. 70 marks, I had no idea what are these questions in paper 1. But somehow I managed to get 110 marks, so 100 marks last year. So that was decent enough considering the type of paper that came. This is how, don't get bogged down by the questions you don't know. Try to attempt those questions which you know very efficiently to maximize your marks in public administration if again the pattern of 2014-15 repeats itself in the next year. If it comes, if the same paper comes for public administration this year, probably Achhe Din for public administration is here. Another important question that has been asked by Mr. Likhit Kumar is that how to make notes from editorials. Okay, this is a very important thing for preparation, notes making. Both the earlier speakers have dealt with it. I will say that you can use any of the modes as online or offline, but I'll say very important is what Sahil was writing, updation of your notes. Because say I did what I, last year I prepared, I'm not very good at notes making, but last year I tried and experimented. So I basically picked up a notebook and wrote different topics of our syllabus and left 4, 4, 5, 5 pages for it, for them. So whenever I say I chose a topic for security and I found an editorial or something relevant to it, I'll read the editorial and write the crux of it, what the message is trying to convey in a very concise manner. And the facts, if there are some certain facts mentioned in the editorial, I'll also write it there. And if some special data reports of different committee, commission or some organization is there, I'll also write it. So in this manner, I say if you do it for 6 to 7 months, you will be having a knowledge of what is happening in the security field for 6 to 7 months. For example, editorials may come for different things. But suppose 5 editorials have come in 3 months for related to security and I have read all the editorials and prepared concise notes, I'll see that this is the flow of security in the recent 5 to 6 months. I'll understand the trends as well as I'll have the material, the data and different views of different organizations over it. And so that I'll be able to use these reports as well as the concept in my answer writing. And I'll also be knowing what is the trend of security in the last 6 months. So this can be done. This can be done online, as I think Sahil was saying. He did it in WordPad. You write the topics the editorial is dealing with. And a single editorial, as I said, can be used for different topics in the GS syllabus. So if you have written topics like agriculture, social justice, and another thing. For example, if the editorial is primarily dealing with agriculture, you write your basic concepts and facts that you get from the editorial on them, the agricultural portion. And then you get the theme of it. Okay, why it is for? It is for social justice, for the justice to the farmers. So try to write in the social justice section that this government step is helping this. It will also help in ethics papers. Try to write the similar editorial in 1-2 line in different portions of your syllabus. So whenever you, before exam, you revise, you'll get to know okay, such thing has happened, and it will help you give good examples also and write the content wherever possible. So this can be about notes making from editorials. Yes, sir.
Sir, for studying history, should the NCERT books be preferred or NIOS books?
I have no idea about the NIOS books. I have read the NCERT. I will not be able to present a comparable analysis, but I think NCERT book is sufficient. Is your optional history?
No, sir.
I think we can do with the NCERT books. No need to waste time by referring to multiple sources. Another, this is very important point. Let me add on to what you have asked. This is the confusion from how many sources we should read a particular material. Because right now, the problem with UPSC preparation is not lack of material, it's the surplus of material. There are large number of sites, large number of coaching institutes providing similar material. So try to limit your source, trust your sources, try to choose a good source, talk to some of the people who are there, they'll advise you good things, and limit your source. Read current affairs from 1 to 2 source. If you are not able to gain confidence by reading to 1 to 2 sources, how will you do so by reading another source? Since there is a limited time for this examination, and people generally feel that they can clear in 1 or 2 years, you have limited time, try to limit your sources so that duplication of efforts is avoided. A large syllabus is there to be covered, and hence do not waste your time by duplication of your efforts. Trust your sources and choose your sources wisely. And another very important thing adding to this is we sometimes get in awe of the people who have been selected, and we miss out the real thing. Perhaps there are very good people who are not in the list. We also should realize it, because such is the UPSC cycle. And we can also learn from that, from them. They have very good answer writing skills. They have very good notes, art of notes making. So if you talk to your friend, you know a guy who is not there in the list but has good notes to the offer. They have good perspectives on essay. They write ethics paper answers. Why not learn from them? Why limit yourself to the people who have been selected? So if you widen your horizon of for section of people from whom you can learn. There are many good people who are not in the list, and they can equally perhaps guide you in a better fashion because they have more experience in the examination, and they have not been selected, but they have the determination as well as the knowledge to clear this examination. So also open your sources to not only people who have been selected, but the people who have been outside the list. They can equally well guide you, and always trust your teachers. I'll say we are standing here also because of our teachers. So we can guide you in some limited aspects, but the teachers are there for you. We are a transient phenomena. Teachers will be there for you permanently. And as I said, we are here because of our teachers. So believe in your teachers also. Other question, please. Ma'am, this is a difficult question, art and culture. But I'll say I read R.S. Sharma, the NCERT book. I read Tamil Nadu NCERT 11th one, and I covered some of the portions from CCRT. Though I did it in a very comprehensive manner, in a very selective manner, because I didn't want to waste my efforts on art and culture. Two questions, I can attempt it in a partial manner with limited knowledge that we have, with the general things that we know. So I didn't waste much time on art and culture, but I read it from these three sources. Yes. बिना कोचिंग के तो कुछ भी प्रिपेयर किया जा सकता है, वो तो आप पे है. तो अगर जैसे आपको अपने ऊपर कॉन्फिडेंस है कि आप कर लेंगे, बहुत लोग आई टी जेई भी अपने बिना प्रिपरेशन के कर लेते हैं, वो आपके ऊपर. अगर आपको अपने ऊपर कॉन्फिडेंस है तो आप करिए. पर जैसे मैं बता रहा हूँ कि फॉर एग्जाम्पल आई एम अ मैकेनिकल इंजीनियर फ्रॉम NIT इलाहाबाद. आई चोज एन ऑप्शनल पब्लिक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन. आई हैड नो आइडिया अबाउट दिस ऑप्शनल इज. So if I say that I'll prepare on my own, probably I am doing an injustice, because I don't know the direction in which this optional needs to be prepared. What is the aptitude for this optional? So if you get a good guidance, your efforts will be on the right direction. There's no harm in choosing a good coaching, good guide, in selecting a good teacher. Because if the direction is right, the first step is right, probably you'll clear it in lesser number of attempts, and you'll get out of this cycle earlier. Otherwise, you will try to read all the things. Probably you will not understand that this is not relevant for the preparation. These are all the things that teachers tell us. So in that way, guidance becomes important. But if you are confident that you are capable enough to prepare on your own, there's nothing harm, no harm in it. Many people, I know a friend of mine who stayed in Dhanbad and prepared and is in the list this time. So there are examples of both. Choose according to your own capacity and capability. Okay, so this was my third interview, and interview is basically they ask questions from your DAF and the experience that you have presented, and some questions related to the general things that are happening and your view on it. As Himanshu was saying, that do not try to fudge, do not try to be dishonest. Because in the panel, it is around 150, 160 years of experience sitting in front of you. They are very smart people. They'll catch you if you are telling dishonest things. I'll say use dishonesty as the last resort if you have nothing to lose there. So maybe it can work in a positive manner. But in general, the principle is that present what you are. you have some unique quality and try to present that. Another question has come from online. It's by Anoop Singh Parihar. I like to add because it is also related to interview experience and types of question asked. As I said, types of questions from the DAF, from what the current affairs and our views on that, and general questions like why you want to do this, and then some situational questions. Suppose you are posted as a district administration on this thing, and how this is the problem, how you'll tackle them, how you'll tackle it, and how you tackle the people that are involved in it. And another thing is that many questions are asked from what you say. So be very conscious of what you are saying. If the question has been asked and you are saying something, that is diverting from the issue, they will divert also. They will ask you a question from there. So be conscious of what you are saying. And in that way, you can also mold your interview. Many people do it very smartly. They answer, even if a question is asked, they try to mold it in their own way. This can be used in a smart manner. For example, you can prepare on your own strength, and if you get an opportunity, try to say this thing related to this question. They'll ask you there only. This is the basic questions. Interview, there's no need to be afraid. Most of the board are very polite, and even if they are not polite, the thing is that they want to put you under stress, and it is also a test. The interview. Your knowledge test was there in mains. The interview is basically a test of your personality. UPSC also says so. So even if you don't know some of the questions, do not show it with your body language. Myself also, and many people also who have done so. If I fail to answer 2 to 3 questions, our whole body goes down. Okay, my interview has gone. It is going down the drain. I'll get very good marks. This is all the feelings that may come in your when you're sitting there. And this is because you always judge yourself. Okay, I have not answered the last question. I have not answered this question. These are the 3 questions that have been asked. So proportional way numbers will go down. This is not the case. They judge you for half an hour period. And probably if you not answer most of the questions also, it will not matter. But your aptitude and approach will matter. If you get crumbled down by knowing the fact that you have not answered a particular questions, it shows a certain thing. You are not expected to know everything. They can ask you. They can always ask you something which you don't know. So never be underconfident that you have not answered some of the questions. Try to present yourself in a very positive manner. Maintain your body language and be calm there. I think these are the things that can help. Anything? Yes.
Questions in interview are asked in rapid fire manner or not?
No. It's not coffee with Karan. It's a professional interview. So that will not be a rapid fire. They'll give you proper time to answer. You will get proper time to answer. If they feel that you are under stress, they'll help you also. They make full use of half an hour to judge your personality. They are not to prejudge you. In some cases, that may be the case, but they give ample opportunity to you from wide the questions. That is why they ask questions from a wide range of topics to see your depth, to see how you analyze, so that in some portions you will be able to. But one thing is very important related to interview, that you should know your background. For example, if I am a mechanical engineer and some very basic questions from mechanical engineer is being asked and I am unable to answer them, it gives a bad feeling to the board, because it gives a feeling to them that this is a guy who has been dishonest in his academic career. It's not that you should know all the concept, but just the basics. One who has been a student of mechanical engineering for four years, and if he is not able to tell the difference between 2-stroke and 4-stroke, it gives a sense of dishonesty. So that should not be there. Some basics, which is a part of your academics, you should know, and you should try to answer those questions well.
Do they ask questions like?
See, I have not experienced those questions, but I have seen them online, as you must have also seen. I think there was an era in which those questions may have been asked, but right now they don't ask such questions. But even if they ask, be ready for it. They can ask you anything, but they are generally not disrespectful. They are not generally personal, and it has not happened with anyone who I know in the past few years. So I'll say this is not the case. Yes, sir.
What type of questions from offshore?
What type of?
Questions from offshore.
It may be the case that no questions may be asked from optional. This time only one question was asked from my optional, and this the question was, why did you choose your optional? Why did you choose public administration? So it had nothing to do with the optional. But if they ask question from the optional, you should be able to tell the basics. Because again, you have used that optional in preparing your exam, so you should be aware about the basics. Even if you, even if you are not remembering the facts and some very nitty-gritty of the syllabus, it's okay. You can say, sir, I am unable to recall that at this point of time, and you can pass that question. But the basics you should know, and it may be the case that no questions from options have been asked.
So what are the mistakes that you did during your last preparations and now?
See, I did a lot of mistakes, and I tried to cover. Those in whatever I was speaking. The first mistake I did, I was also like looking for multiple sources for a similar topic. So that is a duplication of efforts. I'll say, don't do it. Limit your sources and study well from those sources. Another thing is answer writing. One of my friends said it in a very effective manner that this exam is a game of chess, and in the game of chess, the king is the most powerful thing, but queen has the most power. So compare it with this UPSC, the king is the content, but queen is the presentation. So present your answers very effectively, and that will only happen when you do a lot of answer writing. Practice a lot, maybe I was not preparing. And then I will also say that don't get disheartened. As I said earlier, there are UPSC trends. For example, how law people will be feeling this time? I know two selections from law, maybe there will be some more. So is this the case that all law people are bad this time? This does not seem so. While other options are getting 330, law is getting 220, 230, philosophy is getting 250. So there is some sort of trend. Take into consideration that thing also, but you cannot counter that. So I'll say that back yourself up with whatever you have done, whatever preparation you have done. I personally felt that, okay, why I'm not succeeding in public administration, though I put in a lot of effort. Thing came to my mind that I should change my optional. So this was the mistake I didn't commit, I'm saying. So I didn't change my optional, and this time it paid off. Another important thing is that do not try to imitate someone else. For example, generally after the results came out, toppers are treated as celebrities, and whatever they say, gadhe ko ghoda bhi keh denge to log maan lenge. Ye mat kariyega. Apne wahi maine bola, teachers pe trust kariye. Aur apne pe vishwas rakhi. Everybody is unique. They have their own strategy. Try to gain motivation from someone who has cleared this examination, but do not try to imitate them. Build up your own strategy. Try to learn from them how they framed there, if they had one, and follow your own path. You believe in your own hard work, and trust your teachers, I'll say. This is how you should do. Don't try to imitate. This is a very negative thing, because some of us are very good essay writers. And suppose if I am giving you tips for essay, I have a different perspective of essay writing. Maybe you will not be able to do that. You need a simpler approach, because you may not be a good essay writer. So analyze your strengths and weaknesses and prepare a strategy that suits you. Do not try to imitate others. Another important thing is that do not limit yourselves to the notes. I also earlier said that to build your concepts, because you should give some extra time to the optional, because optionals are very important. Optionals like mine and both the earlier speakers, they also help in general studies. Once you have your conceptual clarity in optionals, it helps you. And this paper, whatever the UPSC patterns is, the three papers, essay, ethics and optionals, marks you or breaks you. This is the, if those who score high marks in these three papers generally get good ranks. So optional pe focus karna hai, and read good books on optional. Do not just try to limit yourselves to the notes that are available in the market, because most of the people are reading those notes. If you just will remember and mug up those notes and reproduce in the examination, most of the answers of the people in the examination will be the same. Who else teaches political science, international relations other than Subhrajan ma'am? All the candidates, say 2,000 people are appearing with political science and international relations, will all be writing from them. In also public administration, Ansari sir's note is very popular. If only that note is referred in the examination, most of the answers will be similar, because there are equally hardworking people who are writing mains as you may be. So try to improve your options by reading some books. It will give you more conceptual clarity and help you write better answers. Another thing is, don't waste time. it is unavoidable as far as I was concerned. Generally, when mains get over, we go in the mood of celebration and results come out. We think every time we'll be getting selected in the top ranks and we need not write this examination. So most of the preparation happens between pre and mains. So that is a less time. Probably you'll not be able to do justice to your preparation. Try to prepare also once you have given mains for the next attempt. As Sahil was saying, he got 19th rank. So suppose he must have also felt that I have like my papers have gone well. So suppose if he had left everything and said this time I'll be selected, but somehow things would not have turned out this way, it would have been difficult for him in the next attempt. He would have lost his momentum and all. So try to continue until the results come out. Don't let yourself lose. And also enjoy the life also while you are preparing UPSC. Do not just limit yourself to the academics, because it is a great stress if you do not have any other thing to do. Have some hobby and try to relax also, because if you are only studying, you'll reach a stage of saturation. Probably you'll not be able to focus, you'll not able to analyze things, you'll not able to remember things. So have some diversion also. These are the things that you should do. Anyone, please.
Board asks you a question to change, you don't know about that question, then how to tackle that situation in interview?
If they ask two to three questions that I am not knowing about, I'll say that I don't know about it. But if this extends to 10-15 minutes have been there and I have not been able to answer any of the questions, I'll then try. Because I have to speak something, what they will judge me on if I don't say anything. So you can leave some questions which you don't know, but if that extends to say a larger part of interview, try to speak some basics about it. Do not be mute in the entire interview. Okay, I've got Sahil and Himanshu, please join me here. Now all three of us are here. You can ask any of the questions that you want. I will recall, Sahil's optional is political science and international relations. Himanshu's is anthropology, mine is public administration. If you want to ask questions from the optional. Let's go pull that.
Yes. Or anything we have said so far now? In fact, you should try to do it. You should make an effort when you are studying also that you can relate the concepts of paper 1 and paper 2. You cannot, if you are not related, it will be difficult for you to produce in the examination. You should do it while you are preparing. For example, if you have like notes of paper 2, just write in the bracket, okay, Taylor can be also written. So when you are dealing with that question in the examination, you can write Taylor there. Similarly, other things. They are not. In fact, the entire GS paper is also the same. No syllabus of the UPSC is compartmentalized. You can relate GS1 with ethics. For example, if I am writing ethics, as Sahil was saying, why not use historical examples? In history, there has been some very good episodes where moral lessons have been learned, and those moral lessons are relevant even today. For example, during a war time, if a question is related to ethics of war, and you provide example of some historical battle, it will be very relevant. You can correlate different aspects of the GS syllabus.
What about medical science as optional?
What precisely you want to know, like?
Medical science about as optional.
Medical science you're asking? What medical science? Yeah, please. Yeah, yeah, I've read Andrew Haywood for international relations. That is for part 2.
How to deal with the GS and prelims? We have questions on international relations. And in option also, we have questions on international. What is the difference between these?
In prelims, they usually ask about from organizations, this time they ask which are all countries are part of GCC. So you just make a small note on GCC, these are the countries, this is what it is due, this is the year it is founded, this is the headquarters. Do this much. But when it comes to mains, you need lot of in-depth analysis of that particular topic. So try to read from multiple sources, try to read from Hindu, then your coaching will also provide you notes. Read frontline if there's an issue coming on. I think that will do.
Sir, suggestion for health
for anthropology, there are two papers, paper 1 and paper 2. For paper 1, you need to study some basic books, like try to start from Ember and Ember. This is a very basic book. You'll get an idea of anthropology. Then start reading Peanut. Peanut is a book for physical anthropology. Do this. Then for social anthropology, try to read Nadeem Hasnain. It's a very good book. And also get some notes from of other coaching institutes like Baird's and Braintree. That will give you a more holistic idea. They have covered syllabus wise. So from these four things, the Braintree, Baird's, Ember, and Peanut, you can cover the whole syllabus of paper 1 anthropology. Now coming to paper 2 can be covered through two books apart from Braintree and Baird's. One is the Nadeem Hasnain. For there are actually two parts in paper 2. One is Indian anthropology and other one is tribal part. For Indian anthropology, you should read Nadeem Hasnain. For tribal part also, there is a book of Nadeem Hasnain. Both are very good books. Try to read them and also supplement it with Braintree and Baird's material. So you'll get, also note down the case studies and also make large number of diagrams in the physical anthropology part. And try to incorporate diagrams from, like many toppers have uploaded the diagrams on the different websites, you can refer them. So, regarding? Nadeem Hasnain, try to read all the books of Nadeem Hasnain. These are the basic books, Ember and Ember and Peanut. For anthropology, I didn't took coaching from any of the coaching centers. I referred these sources. I referred Ved's notes and I also went to him for answer writing practice. I think this will help. Book list for GS mains. GS mains comprise of four papers, GS 1, 2, 3, 4. So if for GS 1, there are, this is a very long question. Book list for, okay, so for GS, okay, let me quickly go through this. For GS 1, there are three sections. One is history, one is geography, and one is society. Society has already told by Abhilash. And for history, you should refer the prelims as already discussed, all the books of prelims. And for, I think, world history, you need to refer the books as told by the earlier speakers. Now coming to the geography part, all the prelims part that has already been discussed, try to refer that. For paper 1, I think there is no more things that you need to refer. Supplement these with the current affairs as discussed by the Abhilash. So now coming to paper 2, is more of a dynamic nature. I would say read Lakshmikant, which is compulsory for pre, and also read newspapers very thoroughly. I covered stray topics in paper 2 from Vision IS handouts that can also be done. For example, governance topics, you can also refer that or any other book which you think will suffice. For international relation, I have solely relied upon the newspapers and Vision IS material of current affairs. They are pretty much helpful, and also you can refer a website called Insight IS. I think that will also be helpful for you. For GS paper 3, for economic section, you can, as already discussed, for economy, Mrunal is very good source, and also supplement this with the other economic news that are coming in the newspapers and Vision IS material. And for security section, as already discussed by Abhilash, you can read Ashok Kumar, Ashok Kumar is the name of a security book author. You can read that book and supplement it with the daily security news. For environment, you can read Shankar and supplement it with the NCRT book. And for disaster management, you can read current affairs and supplement it with the NCRT, basic NCRT of disaster management. And then there is science and tech, which require you to read 9th and 10th book of pre, and also for mains, you need to refer current affairs. For GS paper 4, already Sahil has discussed pretty much in very elaborate manner. So I think these are all things that you need to read. And follow this with rigorous practice, then your mains preparation will be very good.
Sir, regarding math, what math we need to practice? Has it need to draw an exact
how we should draw here not.
No, you need to first, okay. So, what I used to do is, there is a YouTube video of how to draw India map in 2 seconds. So, do watch that video. That's a very good video. So, what he used to do is, he used to make 4 dots, and 2 dots here, and 1 dot here. So, here, ऐसे यू कैन ड्रॉ वर्ल्ड मैप वॉच अ यूट्यूब वीडियो सो दैट विल रियली हेल्प. और जैसे अभिलाष ने बताया कि ज्योग्राफी में तो कंपल्सरी बनाओ ही बनाओ, वो तो बहुत ही हेल्पफुल होगा. और प्रैक्टिस करो बहुत ज़्यादा तो क्लैरिटी आ जाएगी, थोड़ा सा बिगड़ जाएगा बट क्लैरिटी आ जाएगी. हाँ चलेगा, मतलब दौड़ेगा चलेगा, अच्छा रहेगा. That's what I told na, don't spend more than 2 months solely on prelims. For example, for GS 1, 2 and 3, if the sources for pre and mains, your preparation should be pre-combines. So write as many tests as possible before pre, for GS 1, 2, 3, and after pre, practice for ethics and essay. So you can do this. And also try to finish your optional before like 4 months of pre, and follow the and keep on doing practice in an interval. So I think this will suffice. For example, I would start with the mains part. I would prepare for example, if I had to write the history test, I would prepare the history. I would write prelims test, then I would write mains test. Because the syllabus is common for both.
But how you start with the
like there are listed books. For example, for modern history, I have Spectrum. I will read the Spectrum book for 2-3 days. Then I will read for medieval history or some ancient history, cultural book. Nitin Singhani, then my history part is prepared. I will go to the mains test series and write a test. I will also go to the prelim test series and write a couple of tests. Then my whole prelim preparation is over. Similarly, I will do this for quality, for geography. I will write part by part. Don't write complete papers. Initially write part by part as told by Abhilash. And later on you can write complete papers. Yeah, topic by topic and anything you can do. I follow a 20-week strategy that I will write 4 papers per week, and then I will write in alternate week I will read resumes week and I will write solved papers. So you can follow your own strategy and try to maximize the papers. I don't make schedule of daily hour schedule like hour basic schedule. I'll only say ki I will give this test on this day and I will follow that schedule next day. So if I have to give test of geography on say 12th, I will give test of geography on 12th, whatever it may be. First main and then pre, followed by pre.
If it can be applied, I said, for example, if there is a news article, for example, let's take a news article. Last year, there's a news article that a DM in Tamil Nadu sat with the deprived section of the society and ate with them. Now this is a simple news. It had some administrative applications also. So if I have a bad topic that talks about role of district magistrate, I will remember that I can use this topic there. I lied somewhere in my public administration that there's such a thing has happened. I have a topic in ethics on leadership. I can quote this example that this DM provided a good example of leadership. So I can use that example there. And if I have a paper of GS2 that talks about social justice, what better example you'll get of social justice? An effort towards providing social justice. So this is how one example can be used in 2-3 papers. But that can only happen, as I said, if you know your syllabus. I think most of us, including me, will not be able to tell what syllabus is. But if you see the syllabus on a daily basis, you'll get to know that okay, these are the sections of my syllabus. So I was preparing only in the first and the second attempt. I was preparing when I was serving. So in the first attempt, since CSAT was there, so much time was not needed. I could manage it. But in the second attempt, like a little more extra effort was required because the CSAT paper was removed. So I devoted some time. I took some leave that I had in my account, managed my time according to my demand of preparation. Like I took out some 1.5 months and prepared. After office hours, there's generally, as I said, 5-6 hours you can get easily after 5:30. There are also Saturdays, Sundays you can utilize. So pre can be, it's manageable. And once you are sure that you have qualified pre, it's now the time to take risk. You can apply for leave and arrange so that you can come wherever you are preparing and utilize your entire time. And in the other two attempts, I did not require because I just skipped foundation course and the time was there with me. The service joining is only after the meets. So in fact, it was not much a challenge. But when you are in job, you should, the bigger challenge is to be determined enough. You should not be complacent that you have a job. That is a more bigger challenge. That is a bigger challenge, in fact. After office hours, you'll get 5-6 hours if you're determined to prepare for this examination. You can manage that. देखिए आइडियल तो ये होना चाहिए कि जब आप प्री दे रहे हैं तो प्री देने से पहले आपका ऑप्शनल तैयार होना चाहिए क्योंकि प्री के मेंस के बीच में इतना समय नहीं है कि आप अपना ऑप्शनल स्क्रैच से तैयार कर पाएँ उसके बीच में तो आंसर राइटिंग और रिवीजन हो जाए वही बहुत बड़ी बात है तो प्री के पहले आपका ऑप्शनल तो तैयार होना चाहिए और ऑप्शनल अब डेली बेसिस पर पढ़ना है कि नहीं मेरे ख्याल से अब प्रिपेयर कर लीजिए उसको तो फिर कोई जरूरी नहीं वो पार्ट आउट की तरह डेली करने क्या जरूरत है मतलब इसको अपना पढ़ लीजिए और बाकी जीएस पे टाइम नहीं एक बार लेकिन पूरा सिलेबस कवर हो जाना चाहिए
Sir, since this exam requires so much of memorizing in history, geography and other subjects, should we start memorizing from the beginning of the year or at the end, like in December or November of the year?
थोड़ा सा इस एग्जाम में मेमोराइजिंग तो चाहिए दिस एग्जाम रिक्वायर्स मेमोराइजिंग बट आई विल नॉट से दैट इट रिक्वायर्स सो मच ऑफ मेमोराइजिंग बिकॉज नाउ डेज पैटर्न हैव चेंज आई थिंक बोथ ऑफ देम विल अग्री विद मी दैट पैटर्न हैव चेंज यू रिक्वायर more analytical skills and more like I said relating of different aspects of the topic and dealing topic in a comprehensive manner but still some things need to be remembered especially historical facts certain figures certain reports commissions and that if you read 2-3 times will automatically be in your mind and if someone requires more revision that is why revision also becomes very important Sahil was saying that he did revision on Sundays after 6 days of study So that he was doing so that he could recollect what all he has studied. So that is sort of revision to remember what you have studied. You can use that technique also. You need to remember some things, that is true. And you should make a conscious effort also to remember such some things. But it is not a rote learning example anymore.
Sir, 6 to 9 NCERT is for about 50%.
वो समय पे है जैसे मान लीजिए आप अटेम्प्ट दे रहे हैं आपके पास समय नहीं तो जैसे मेरे पास नहीं समय था तो मैंने 9 से 12 पढ़ ली आपके पास जो अगले साल प्रोग्राम कर रहे हैं उनके पास समय है तो वो 6 से 12 तक पढ़ सकते हैं और डीपली क्या पढ़ेंगे 6 से 9 तक की किताब वो इतनी हल्की होती है उसको कितना डीप में जाएंगे उसमें तो स्ट्रेट अवे लिखा है
So what are the basics
book
that you refer for your optional papers? Can you please name down the must read book?
For paper 1, part 1, I read O.P. Goba. And I strictly referred ma'am notes for paper 1. I didn't read any book, to be very honest with you. For paper 1, part 2, I read B.L. Fadia, Indian Administration. And then for the paper 2, I read Andrew Haywood.
Okay. International. Yeah, international relation. I read Andrew Gavin. That's it.
So this question is for Sahil sir and Himanshu sir. So what different strategies you adopted for this attempt that you think worked for you as compared to the previous attempts?
Yeah, for me, I think I practiced more this time. I wrote essay test, I enrolled in Vision. I write, out of 5, I write 4 essays. Also for mains, I practiced regularly this time because in my second attempt, I didn't practice well, so I get low marks. This time, I kept on writing my tests on time. Also for the option as well, I keep revising things, I keep writing tests. That's why I think I got good marks in mains.
For me, I think giving more and more number of tests, and as you can see, right, making more and more diagrams and flow charts, I think these are all worked. Don't skip any questions in the main examination. Attempt all the questions because I have skipped some questions in the previous attempt, and I think they really pulled down my marks. So don't skip any question. Attempt all of them, and practice more and more. Write large number of tests. I think you may easily say.
Insights on India. So there are daily 10 secret articles coming out in Insights. So do you read them on a regular basis?
I used to read the daily current affairs from Insights on India also, and also Vision IS, so, and also the Hindu. So all of the three, I used to make notes from all the three.
So you don't go through all the 10 articles?
No, you don't get much time to read all of them. So try to limit your source and revise them multiple times. That's why when I quoted the subjects for prelims and sources for prelims, I limited I told very few books, because read those books 10 times, 8 times, that will help more rather than reading multiple books for one source, for one subject. So I think you should not read more books. Try to read one book many times.
So one entrance of Hindu per day suffice.
I think Hindu plus, not only editorial, the entire newspaper, the Hindu, complete Hindu, along with the Vision.
Coverage of the newspaper and including the editorial of the, so one editorial, you don't have to go through all the editorials.
No, I don't, I have never went through all the editorials. Whatever important comes, we used to discuss among the friends, and I used to jot down what my friend used to say, that this important article has come into this newspaper. So if there is something like that, you can note down that. But I don't find much time to go through all of the 10 newspaper articles, because I have to write test every alternate day. So current affairs, not very much relevant, but I mean, you can wait till the end, go to some coaching institute, get all the current affairs of the year and study it. For paper two, it is good, because you can quote the case studies from the current affairs, and it always gives you an edge when you write the current affairs or any case study that has come up recently. For example, Niyamgiri case in for example, the Quant tribals. So you can quote all these cases, and it also there are a couple of sites. Tribal India is there, and one more site is there. I'm forgetting the name. I have the list. You can take it. You can take it. Get enrolled into PhD into IIT, that then you need to spend more and more time, because it's a very huge commitment that you are making, and it depends upon your professor under whom you are doing your doctorate. But for me, I rejected the I could not enroll for PhD, and I did my MS and I came out.
there was an offer of PhD, but I didn't join because when you join PhD, your whole balance shift towards writing papers, publishing papers. So if you are very focused toward UPSC, I think for refreshment, go for jogging and all. I think you can balance it. 2 years is a good amount of time, but you need to be very specific and you need to be very directional. Then you will qualify, and be very specific and be very directional. Don't look for many sources. Read very limited sources, and you will be able to qualify. कुछ कुछ सब्जेक्ट्स के लिए ओल्ड अच्छी है, कुछ कुछ के लिए नहीं अच्छी है. फॉर एग्जांपल हिस्ट्री के जो एंशियंट है उसके लिए ओल्ड अच्छी है आर एस शर्मा और सतीश चंद्रा मेडिवल के लिए. बाकी जो अभी हिस्ट्री की जो नई नई बुक्स आई हैं न्यू एनसीईआरटी वो अच्छी हैं, काफ़ी अच्छी हैं. मतलब उन्हीं को पढ़ लो आप, बहुत अच्छी हैं. हाँ न्यू एनसीईआरटी
You personally come from an engineering background, so how did you find the physical anthro part of paper?
I think that was the question that came to my mind, and I was very much in confusion whether I should take the anthropology or not, because it has a physical anthropology part which is more of a biological in nature. But it is not very core biology, it's very simple biology that we also study as part of our GS course. So I think we can take anthropology, and there is no need to worry about the physical anthropology, which is biological part. They will ask very day-to-day questions, daily life science questions. For example, how this disease is prevalent in the Mediterranean region. Then you need to write very simple answers, the logical answers. So I think it can be covered with 11th and 12th biology, which we also read as part of our GS course. NCERT will give you, for example, a foundation. If you directly jump to coaching notes, they will have, they are made by someone from NCERTs. So directly, why don't you read the NCERTs first? Then your foundation will be very strong. And then on top of it, you can build through advanced books. So I think NCERT you should read. They are very simple and they are very comprehensive. So you can read NCERTs. Also, there is an app of Vision IS. You can also install it in your mobile. I think it will help you a lot. And whenever you can travel into metros, because I personally installed it, and I think it works. You can also give test upon the Vision IS app. Any other question?
Alright, thank you guys for joining us today. So we'll leave right now. If you guys have any more questions, you can ask it later on or forward it to them personally.